She joins us now in the studio. Thanks for coming in.
Thank you.
That's a lot of money. Where do you come up with that figure of $168 million?
Yes, and I think it's actually a very conservative figure. We went to the Parliamentary Budget Office to provide a costing on what it would look like if we did not arrest people who had in their possession a small amount of an illicit substance. And they did those costings largely on the court costs that we currently experience for those types of crimes and some of the police costs. It didn't look at the downstream effect of that, of what that would have on health and society generally.
So you're looking at the model here being Portugal, which went down this path over 15 years ago.
That's right. So Portugal went down this path in 2001. And in fact, I was very fortunate to visit there a couple of times, but last year with a cross-party, multi-house drug law reform committee, and we saw firsthand how the police dealt with it and how the society fully accepted that. It enabled people to get into treatment rather than get into jail.
So it's not open slather. You're not saying people can take whatever drugs they like and there's no repercussions.
Absolutely not. And in fact, you know, the sale and the provision of drugs and the distribution of drugs and the manufacturing of them is all illegal. And this enables the police to probably focus more on that. But when a young person is caught in a park or, you know, in a nightclub with a substance, they are interviewed by a social worker and a psychologist, and they give them an assessment and they provide them with some treatment options. Sometimes that treatment is getting them back on track with employment or education. So it's a very broad approach and very effective.
Given crime is such a major issue in this state, you're going in the opposite direction, certainly to the Liberals and even Labor when it comes to being tough on crime.
Yeah, I think I'm actually being smart on crime. And, you know, Richard Branson was out here recently in support of the decriminalisation approach. And he said, as a businessman, if I had anything to do with the 60-year war on drugs, I would have stopped it 59 years ago. It doesn't make sense. It's extremely expensive. So I think for both sides of Parliament, I hope that we can bring them to the table to look at pragmatic solutions, because keeping on doing the same thing that we've been doing doesn't work and it's creating harm. I mean, we've got some of the highest overdose levels not only in Australia but also in the world.
And related to this in a way, Richmond is an area where you've had the safe injecting room set up.
Yes.
It's also become a hot issue politically today because the Liberals said they won't field a candidate there. The flow-on effect could mean minor parties such as yours have a major influence.
Well, that's right. I mean, I think it's interesting that they've been out on an attack on the supervised injecting centre, yet they won't stand a candidate to defend that position. However, yes, we have a wonderful candidate running for Reason in Richmond, Judy Ryan, and she's been a great local citizen, and I think, you know, she might be able to do a Bradbury on this. It will certainly enable us to pick up more votes and play a bigger part in it.
This will be the first state election since you changed the name from the Sex Party to the Reason Party.
Yes.
Do you think you're losing brand recognition by doing that?
Look, I think Sex Party was well known, but not necessarily well voted for. Certainly out there on the hustings, we're getting a really great response to the name change. And I think, you know, a voice of reason in Parliament, who wouldn't want one?
We'll find out November 24. Thanks for coming
in
today.
Thank you.
Fiona Patten.